Welcome to another video of Ancient Greece Reloaded. In this video, we will talk about the legendary kings of Sparta. If you like the video, please do not forget to click the like icon, the subscribe button, so as to support the project of Ancient Greece Reloaded, and also click on the bell icon, so as to become aware of our newest videos. Also, due to video timely constraints, we cannot go into much details, thus, if you want to read more about these kings that we will talk about, you can find all relevant information in the video description below. Finally, when we talk about the legendary kings, we are referring to a timeline of roughly 100,000 BC and back in time. Thus, we are referring to an era that falls around the Bronze Age and the Heroic Age. That being said, let us begin. The first king in the line of the legendary kings was Lelex or Lelegas. In Greek mythology, Lelex was one of the original inhabitants of Laconia, which was called at that time, after him, its first king, Lelegia. Lelex was said to be autochthonous, or his father is said to be the sun god Helios, thus making him a demigod, or semigod to be more precise. He was married to the nymph Cleocharia and became the father of several sons, including Miles and Polycaon. Through Miles, Lelex was the grandfather of Evrotas, who had a daughter named Sparta. This woman later married Lacedaemon, who named the city of Sparta after his wife. However, the city's name would also be his own, as it was called either Lacedaemon or Sparta. Finally, sources indicate that Perseus, the legendary hero, is a descendant of Lelex. Why? Because Lelex's great-granddaughter Sparta gave birth to a daughter named Evridike, who had married Acrisius, the king of Argos. Evridike became the mother of Danae, thus making her Perseus' grandmother. Next is Miles. Miles or Miles was the son of Lelex and would become the next king of Laconia. He invented the millstone. The name for it derives from Miles. Miles, Milopetra, millstone in Greek. His son Evrotas would become the next king of Laconia. What is more, Miles had also a brother called Polycaon. Since Lelex gave the throne to Miles, Polycaon started to travel around Peloponnese. Eventually, he would marry a princess called Mycenae. But Mycenae was an ambitious woman that did not want to be married to a nobody. Thus Polycaon, with the help of his father-in-law, marched his army into an area that he did conquer and named after his wife Mycenae, aka Mycenaea. The couple ruled the area successfully and lived happily ever after. The funny thing is that centuries later Mycenaea would become something like a vassal state to Sparta. In simple terms, since Sparta was more of a warrior-type-oriented society, they did not have enough farmers to feed them. Thus Sparta would turn Mycenaea into its vassal state, taking from them what they needed and would leave whatever was left to Mycenaean citizens, aka Sparta was oppressing Mycenaea. Many times Mycenaea would try to revolt only to be smashed to pieces by Sparta. As if this was not enough, Cryptea, the ninja division of the Spartan warriors, would train the rookies by sending them into Mycenaea so as to kill a few of their inhabitants, with the core mission of not getting caught or seen. Well, you get the picture. The next legendary king is Evrotas. Evrotas was the son of King Miles and grandson of Lelex and was the third king of Laconia. Evrotas had no male heir, but he did have two daughters, Sparta and Thiasse. The river of that area would be named after the king of Evrotas for the following reason and based on Pausanias. It was Evrotas who channeled away the marsh water from the plains by cutting through to the sea, and when the land was drained, he called the river, which was left running there, the Evrotas. Moving on to the next king, Lacedaemon. Lacedaemon was a mythical king of Laconia. Later on, Sparta became its capital, and son of the Pleiad, Taygete and Zeus. Later on, Lacedaemon would grow up into a handsome young man, and eventually Lacedaemon would arrive in the kingdom of Laconia, which at the time was ruled by Evrotas. Evrotas had two beautiful daughters. He was so impressed by Lacedaemon that he promptly wed one of these daughters, Sparta, to Lacedaemon. As already mentioned, the third legendary king Evrotas had no sons, and so the kingdom of Laconia was passed to his son-in-law Lacedaemon. Lacedaemon would rename the kingdom after himself, while he also built a new city which he called Sparta after his wife. Thereafter, the names of Lacedaemon and Sparta, as well as Lacedaemonians and Spartans, were used interchangeably. The wife of Lacedaemon would give birth to two children, a son called Amyclas and a daughter called Evridike. Lacedaemon would be succeeded as king of Laconia by his son Amyclas. Finally, the lambda that you see in the shields of the Spartans comes from the first letter of Lacedaemon's name as well as that of Lelex, so as to create a historical depth. Moving on, Amyclas. Amyklas, who was the son of King Lacedaemon and Queen Sparta and brother of Queen Evrydike of Argos. He married Diomede, or Diomede in Greek, and had a few children that later on became kings and queens in various other regions. Not much else is known about him besides of the fact that he was also the great uncle of Perseus. The next king was Argalus. Argalus was the eldest son and heir of King Amyklas of Sparta and his wife Diomede, daughter of Lapithes. Through this parentage, he was considered to be the brother of King Kinortes, his successor, Iacynthus, Polyvia, Laodamia, and in other versions of Daphne. Argalus was also said to be the father of King Ivalus. If the aforementioned names do not ring a bell to you, let me just say that each one of them has their own story in the pages of Greek mythology. Next in line was Kinortas. Kinortas was the son of King Amyklas, and thus brother to King Argalus. He became king of Sparta when his brother, the previous king, died or passed away. He was the father of Ivalus, who became the next king. Thus, the next king in line was Ivalus. Ibalus, or Ivalus, or however he is pronounced, was the 8th legendary king of Sparta. Without going much into the family tree, which starts to become ballistic, the interesting thing about this king is that he became the son-in-law of the hero Perseus, via his second marriage. On top of that, he was father to Tyndareus, who was the father of the beautiful Helen, hence also grandfather to the famous heroes known as Dioscuri, while his children would also marry various kings and queens. Next in line is Hippocoon. Hippocoon was the son of the Spartan king Ivalus and Vatia. His brothers, or half-brothers, were Tyndareus and Icarius. When their father died, Tyndareus became king. Hippocoon, with the help of his sons, overthrew him, took the throne and expelled his brothers from the kingdom. Later, Hippocoon would refuse to cleanse Heracles after the death of Iphitus. Please keep in mind that in ancient times, the kings had the right to cleanse someone from any crime, like the Pope during the Middle Ages. Because of that, Heracles became hostile to Hippocoon, killed him, and reinstated Tyndareus. All of Hippocoon's sons were also slain by Heracles as a revenge for the death of the young Oeonus, whom they had killed because he had stoned their dog in self-defense. Heracles' allies in the war against Hippocoon were Cepheus of Arcadia and his 20 sons, who all, as well as Heracles' brother Iphicles, died in the battle. According to Diodorus, 3 of Cepheus' sons did survive. Finally, according to Pausania, there used to be a statue of Heracles in Sparta wielding weapons which symbolized his fight against Hippocoon in support to Tyndareus. Next king was Tyndareus. After Hippocoon was kicked out of the throne, Tyndareus would become the next king. He married the princess Leda, by whom he became the father of Castor, Clytemnestra, Timandra, Phoebe and Philoni, and the stepfather of the beautiful Helen and Pollux. By the way, Castor and Pollux were the famous heroes known as Dioscuri. Based on Stesichorus, a Greek lyric poet, when Tyndareus was making an offering to the gods, he forgot to make an offering to the goddess Aphrodite. Hence Aphrodite returned the favor by making his daughters to become unfaithful and frivolous. Finally, the famous oath of Tyndareus is related to him, and the story goes as follows. Helen was the most beautiful woman in the world, and when it was time for her to marry, many Greek kings, heroes, etc. came to seek her hand or sent emissaries to do so on their behalf. They became known as the suitors of Helen. Among the suitors of Helen were Odysseus, Ajax the Great, Diomedes, Idomeneus, and both Menelaus and Agamemnon. All but Odysseus brought many and rich gifts with them. Helen's favorite was Menelaus, who, according to some sources, did not come in person but was represented by his brother Agamemnon, who chose to support his brother's case, and he himself married Helen's half-sister Clytemnestra instead. Tyndareus would accept none of the gifts, nor would he send any of the suitors away, for fear of offending them and giving grounds for a quarrel. Odysseus promised to solve the problem in a satisfactory manner, if Tyndareus would support him in his courting of Penelope, the daughter of Icarius. Tyndareus agreed, and Odysseus proposed that before the decision was made, all the suitors should swear a most solemn oath to defend the chosen husband against whoever should quarrel with the chosen one. The strategy succeeded, and Helen and Menelaus were married. Eventually, Tyndareus resigned in favor of his son-in-law, and Menelaus became king. Some years later, Paris, a Trojan prince, came to Sparta to marry Helen, whom he had been promised by Aphrodite. If you guys are confused, this is related with the myth of Ares, in which he had to choose which goddess is the most beautiful one, and he chose Aphrodite in return to marry Helen. Helen left with him either willingly, because she had fallen in love with him, or because he kidnapped her, depending on the source, leaving behind Menelaus and Hermione, the 9-year-old daughter of them. Menelaus attempted to retrieve Helen by calling on all his former suitors to fulfill their oaths, leading to the Trojan War. Menelaus. In Greek mythology, Menelaus was king of Sparta after his father-in-law gave him the throne. Menelaus was the husband of Helen of Troy and the son of Atreus and Aerope. According to the Iliad, Menelaus was a central figure in the Trojan War, leading the Spartan group of the Greek army under his elder brother Agamemnon, king of Mycenae. Prominent in both the Iliad and the Odyssey, Menelaus was also popular in Greek vase painting and Greek tragedy. Menelaus was also among the heroes inside the Trojan horse. After the Trojan War, and as it happened to many Greek heroes, Menelaus' homebound fleet was blown by storms to Crete and Egypt, where they were becalmed, unable to sail away. They trapped Proteus and forced him to reveal how to make the voyage home. By the way, Proteus was a sea god whose daughter helped Menelaus to trap his father so as to help them. His son-in-law Orestes would marry Hermione and thus would become the next king of Sparta. Finally, and according to Euripides' Helen, Menelaus is reunited with Helen after death on the Isle of the Blessed. The next king is Orestes, or Orestes. Orestes was the son of Clytemnestra and Agamemnon, by marrying Hermione, the daughter of Menelaus and Helen. In the Homeric telling of the story, Orestes is a member of the doomed house of Atreus, which is descended from Tantalus and Niobe. Orestes is absent from Mycenae when his father Agamemnon returns from the Trojan War with the Trojan princess Cassandra as his concubine and thus not present for Agamemnon's murder by Aegisthus, the lover of his wife Clytemnestra. 7 years later, Orestes returns from Athens and avenges his father's death by slaying both Aegisthus and his own mother Clytemnestra. There are various stories regarding Orestes' life, so if you guys are interested to learn more about it, see the links in the video description below. Also, as a side note, the doomed house of Atreus, which is descended from Tantalus and Niobe, it was called the doomed house because of the following reasons. Tantalus, among the various crimes that he did commit, the final one being when he tried to serve human flesh to the gods. Niobe, on the other hand, being arrogant against the gods, but also claiming that she and her children are more beautiful than the gods themselves. As you can imagine, not only were they punished, but also the descendants had to pay for the crimes as well. The next and final king of the legendary kings of Sparta was Tisamenus. Tisamenus was the son of Orestes and Hermione. Tisamenus succeeded his father to the throne of Argos, Mycenae and Sparta, so basically he was ruling three areas simultaneously. Tisamenus was later killed in the final battles against the Heraclides, who sought to retake Peloponnese as their ancestral land. To help you understand what was going on, the Heraclides were the numerous descendants of Heracles, especially applied in a narrower sense to the descendants of Helus, the eldest of Heracles' four sons by Deianira. Historically, this event is also known as the Dorian invasion or the return of the Heraclide. Following Tisamenus' death, the victors divided his lands among them. Sparta ended up in the hands of Aristodemus and his twin sons Eurysthenes and Procles, jointly receiving the throne of Sparta. Finally, the historical kings of Sparta belonged to the co-ruling houses of Eurysthenes and Procles, who became the ancestors of the two royal houses of Sparta. Okay, what does this mean? It means that the line of the legendary kings of Sparta started with Lelex and ended with Tisamenus. Of course, descendants of them survived, but we are referring here solely to the royalties in regards of ruling Sparta. The historical line of the kings of Sparta belongs to Eurysthenes and Procles, who were descendants of Hercules. And that is also why, in the trailer of the movie 300, you hear them say that Spartans, we are the descendants of Hercules, or something like that. Finally, at this point we have reached the end of our video. If you would like to read more about what we did discuss in this video, check out the links provided in the video description below. Do not forget to like our video and to subscribe to our channel so as to support the project of Ancient Greece Reloaded, and to click the bell icon as well. Thanks for watching and stay tuned for upcoming videos.